All right, let's get moving on this. I don't have work today. And while the sun is out and it's not too chilly, let's tape because at nighttime it gets so dark. I'm having a hard time taping. So I'm making some other videos, that the last couple of videos you've seen, that a little departure from what I normally do, but I've enjoyed doing them. That's for sure. They're very time intensive. What we're going to cover here today is quite a bit, quite a bit. Plausible inference is increasing to an extraordinary extent. And the meditation contemplation I had this morning was the deepest ever. And so I'm just in the wow phase of that. And this is the new normal for me. Just this is the new normal. When you go through a very intense contemplation, then at some point you realize, okay, now it's time to just get used to this being the new normal. This information, this clarity is the new normal for me. And this is what I'm in the phase right now. But along with this, I've been a continual drumbeat of plausible inference for events coming up in 2016. And I have a long, long history in my life of being accurately aware of events that are to come. The two the people would say most noticeable is 9/11 and the Boxing Day tsunami in the Indonesian tsunami, and then the Ukrainian problem. I hit that almost to the day. So I've gotten better at pinpointing dates. It's quite difficult, and locations and all this. This is difficult. So, but there have been thousands and thousands of times in my life when I've been aware of what's going to happen. I've been accurate. But the truth is, I don't want any legacy as a prophet or someone who foretells the future. I'm not interested in that at all. I'm interested in a legacy of clarity, clarity, in an indescribable, indefinable, immeasurable legacy, which is the legacy of the Holy Spirit, actually. The Holy Spirit is our legacy of honoring creativity. Before we drop pretension, and our creativity stays with us, and we continue being creative, just not we won't be creatively pretentious. So, the legacy, our legacy, actually, the Holy Spirit has produced a legacy for us. So, I'm moving towards accepting that legacy of the Holy Spirit for honoring creativity and pretension, pretending to not be what we are. So. I'm not looking to be a prophet. A prophet foretells things. If I foretold so many things accurately, that if people were looking, if I was trying to be a prophet, then you would think that there would be a great sensation. Oh, this person knows this. And now anybody can know what's going to take place. It doesn't mean really much of anything. All intention is known to the mind. There's one mind, and intention is, we're all aware of intention, and so. For me, it's just okay. So what? But what? You know, something's going to happen. Okay. Well, what's an alternative? What are our options? That's what I'm more interested in. So the less emphasis I try to put on myself, I know the future, blah blah blah. The more emphasis I put on, well, what are our options? The more clarity comes. The more clarity comes. And there are some people who are pointing out pretty accurately what's going to happen, and yet they're still falling in the trap of, like, I'm a prophet of God. God spoke to me and told me this is going to happen. Da 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 da. I'm special or something. That's okay. That's okay. But I'm not interested in that. I'm interested again in what are our options? How do we exercise our options? And has it, you can break it down into legacy. What do we want our legacy to be? So I don't want to go too fast here. This is just what this video will explore. And I've been able to pinpoint a date for troubles in this world. I have had just this cascade of plausible inference situations from all angles around a common theme. Unmistakably common theme. So this is when you get this constellation of a common theme in all these synchronicitous, serendipitous events and circumstances. You meet this person. I mean, I pull into a gas station. I get out, and somebody's else is there on the other island, He just says, "Hey, I like your hat." And I say, "Oh, yeah." And we get into a little conversation, and then the whole thing turns, and he starts dropping all this inference about what's to happen. It's amazing. I realized, oh my gosh, okay, let me just pay attention to this. Well, this has been going on for months and months and months. And in dreams, I had a dream 2 nights ago that I am just getting over the shock of it. It was so extraordinary, and I've been researching it and looking into it. And again, it's the common theme of what is to come. And so I just adjusted this here as we catch our breath here. But again, I don't want the focus to be on that in particular. However, when we're aware that something is coming into this world, then that puts our attention more on, okay, what are our options? We don't want to be blindsided by this. We do not want to be blindsided by it. So it's not a negative thing. It's a positive thing to realize, hey, okay, there's an event that's plausible inference that this event could take place. There is a lot. Certainly, I don't seem to. How could I be orchestrating unless, well, at some level, the mind's orchestrating everything? So you can always say, well, it's self-deception possible. Of course, it always is in these cases. But when you get so many, 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 many different types of things involving many different people, animals, plants, you name it, all of nature here, everything is singing in harmony. Then, you start paying attention. Start paying attention. And good grief, this dream that I had, just an extraordinary dream, something that could not come from my own psyche about my own life, thinking about my life. This had to do with a world event. Because and then there was this young, in the dream, there was this young woman that seemed to be a guru figure, like a Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma figure, young, looked like her when she was young. And she was there, and she said, Oh, you saw that, huh? And I said, yeah. She goes, yeah. Yeah, that happens here. Totally aware of it. What the dream that I had just had. So you had someone in the dream that was aware of what I had just experienced in the dream, affirming that yes, this indeed happens here, and this is affirming this is going to happen. Yeah, this is something that happens here, and yet being completely undisturbed by it. And it was that teacher, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, in a dream back in like 1997, that again pointed out we're going to get hit, but she acted out very, very powerfully for me. We get blindsided in this world. But this is just a tiny little bit of all the different inferences that have been happening. So, there are people talking about who've also picked up in the mind, in the level of intention, what's going to happen, intention. They've also become aware of this. There are some that have, and they call themselves, they're preachers, people of God, stuff like this. That's fine. However they want to identify themselves is fine. I just choose not to do that. My focus is on non-dual abidance. Okay, non-dual abidance and clarity. But I do include this information because the drumbeat is unavoidable. And when you get these dreams that appear to have these great teachers also pointing it out, saying, yeah, then, okay, pay attention to it. But it's still, what do we do about it? This is interesting. Now, somebody's had this website for a long time talking about what's to come in the world, and they've been fairly accurate, actually, probably more accurate about anybody. They said they're shutting down their website in January, early January, and they said that's it, that the troubles are going to come and there's going to be some sort of evacuation, etc. All this interesting. They have actually now said that they've got the information, the time is now. Well, I don't have that particular information, that the there's going to be evacuation right now and all this kind of stuff. Maybe there will be. That'd be fine if there was. The focus is still the same on clarity and the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the one that has our legacy. Okay. Now, I don't want to cause any panic or troubles or people saying, oh, this, that. But I'm just saying there's plausible inference, okay, here. I've detected a large amount of plausible inference that space rocks are going to impact the Earth. They are going to impact the Earth. This is plausible inference, not a prediction, nor a prophecy. I'm just saying I've been experiencing a constellation of plausible inference and been aware of this my entire life, actually. So certainly at some level of intention of the mind, there is this possible scenario. And to pinpoint where it's going to happen is in the Caribbean area. I've been through many dreams pointing out stuff. It always focuses on this area. It's amazing. Just extraordinary dreams where I said, that's so odd, I gotta research this, and then wow. Okay, it just keeps focusing on this area. So it's not like God said, hey, this is going to happen there. It's all this different constellation in many different angles, all pointing to the same area. Okay, so then I start saying, well, that's plausible inference. It's reasonable to draw an inference from all this. It could be a space rock coming in, fragmenting into three different fragments. It's quite possible. And coming into the Atlantic Ocean area around near the Caribbean, near Jamaica, or that sort of area, it could hit in different areas, but probably in that Caribbean area. There's Puerto Rico, Dominican Republic, and Haiti, and then there's Cuba, and then there's just south of us, Jamaica. So it's in the general, we don't have to pinpoint anything. It's just in the general area, that Caribbean area. And what is indicated is there is going to be a very big tsunami that washes over a lot of land. No question about it. I don't know exactly where that land would be, but inferences also have suggested a certain area. We don't want to drive real estate prices down, and people get upset, right? The realtors might get upset, homeowners might get upset. But you can probably draw inferences, reasonable inferences, that the southern part of the United States, Florida, the Gulf states along there, maybe the coast, the eastern coast of the United States. I mean, we're talking about issues. It could be New Mexico, Yucatan, down there. That whole area, as well as across the Atlantic. I mean, we're talking about definite, plausible inference for troubles. Now, also, this is quite extraordinary, is I've been able to pinpoint a time, as the Holy Spirit has told me now for over a year, I would say, has been constantly saying, look, you've got to be spiritually prepared going into June and put the icing on the cake in June. But really, right now, I'm getting 5 months through May, put all out effort through May, and then in June, we will see where things stand, and then the trouble will come in July. Whatever, there's some trouble coming in July, and it's coming July 24th, I would say. This is the date that I have plausibly inferred from a lot of different information. It's quite extraordinary. And so I looked up July 24th, and then the Holy Spirit said, look up on the Jewish calendar, July 24th, 2016. So I did, and this is Tzom, T-Z-O-M, Tammuz, or something like that. It's a holiday, which is the day of where the walls of Jerusalem were breached. A lot of bad stuff in Jewish history has happened. And they start this period of mourning. Quite extraordinary. Quite extraordinary. That the date that I was able to plausibly infer from a lot of different inferences happens to be that 24th, happens to be this Jewish holiday, which is historically a day of disaster. Stone tablets were broken. Moses' stone tablets were broken on this day, or this date commemorating the breaking of the stone tablets, stones being broken. It's pretty extraordinary. I just like, wow. So, again, no prophecy, no prediction at all, but I'm saying there's a consolation of plausible inference enough to be a major attention getter. That, and I'm not the only one saying this. There are others who have brought this up. They have their own way of you know, they say, well, God spoke to them, or they saw a movie, or they were able to see inner vision, or yeah, that's fine. Those are other ways to infer something's going to happen. It doesn't mean it's going to happen, but it doesn't mean it's not going to either. There's no question that the symbology I've gotten in the meetings, chance meetings, encounters, serendipitous stuff. It's interesting. You meet strangers, they're much more likely to get the Holy Spirit talking through them than people you know. People you know well, they're very defended against you, one another, right? They've kind of come to agreement. This is what we'll say, and this is what we won't say. You meet someone at a gas station, you strike up a conversation, a stranger, then you never see him again. They might just talk freely. They tend to talk more freely. And then the Holy Spirit speaks through them. And it is quite extraordinary, the meeting I had. Quite extraordinary. Wow. So I would not be the slightest bit surprised if such an event does happen. The preparation, spiritual preparations, seem to be going very intensely right now. Today I was willing to accept a little substantive help today. You know, we shouldn't ask the Holy Spirit for help, because it's kind of like saying that it's holding help back from us, which is not true. It's us that are not accepting the help. And I realized that. I said, I don't want any help because I say, no, I'm not worth it. I'm not valuable enough for any help. I don't deserve to be helped. So maybe that's why I haven't gotten any help. Well, I'm sure it has to be, because the Holy Spirit's not holding anything back from us. We have to say, okay, I'll accept some help. So I said, I'll accept a little bit of substantive help, not too much, because I'm still, you know, unsteady in terms of my clarity and all that. But this morning I said, okay, I'll accept a little bit of help. So I wonder how that's going to play out. Not too much. I don't want to be pressured with, you know, a lot of help, but then I'm not able to live up to that. So, I felt I had a little bit of value in terms of spiritual value, a little bit of value here. I'm digging very, very deep into the whole situation and able to do it and able to see this is the new norm and feel comfortable with it. So I say, okay, maybe I can be helpful in some way going forward. That's possible. So I'll accept a little bit of help from the Holy Spirit in that direction. So, very positive. That's very positive. Also, plausible there'll be a terrible refugee problem in the United States and in Europe and a lot of countries impacted. I think the wave is going to spread out in all directions. The tsunami is going to spread out in many directions and have impact, quite a substantial impact. A very severe refugee issue has been indicated. one of the ways, I don't want to go into too much detail because people start saying, wait a minute. Again, it's a constellation. It's the overall weight of plausible inference that leads to saying, to talking about something like that. It's not any one thing. It's dissected and separated out. The ego will try to separate it out and evaluate from that. It's not how you can look at it that way. If you look at it that way, you'll get all confused, which the ego loves of confusion, of course. But I keep having these dreams of the brown recluse spider, and people mentioning it to me. It's so extraordinary. And I say, why? I keep having these dreams. There's people warning me about the brown recluse spider. I said, am I going to get bit? But I looked up, and there are no brown recluse spiders in California. So I said, what in the world is going on? I've never seen one. I just do not understand this. I had some guy who was carrying some lumber. I saw him carry some lumber. Suddenly he messed out a shout. Ah! And later I asked him, what happened? He said, there's a spider walking by my feet. And I said, were you scared? He said, oh, no, it just startled me. He said, spiders don't bother me. I said, what about black widow? He says, nah, they don't bother me. He says, but the brown recluse spider does. That really bothers me. And then he went on to this big talk about the brown recluse spiders and all this stuff. And I said, huh? I've never seen one here. So, oh, yeah. Yeah, they're here. But they're not. And in the dream, they kept saying, no, the spider's coming. The spider's coming. And I said, what? I said, no. There's no spiders in this house. And it went on and on with the symbology about carob bean bars or chocolate bars, cocoa bars, carob bean bars. And eating them, and they're all emptied out. The whole package was emptied out. And then they said, yeah, see, the spider was in that package, and now it's coming into your house and invading your house. And I said, what? But these are like three nights in a row, brown recluse spider. I said, this is just bizarre. What is going on? So I finally went and looked at the habitat, a map of the habitat of the brown recluse spider, and boom, there it was. It's in the Midwest, and mostly in the South area. And it borders the whole area of the Gulf, kind of the Gulf states down into Florida and that area. And I looked at it, I said, wow, that certainly looks like a map of an area that could be severely impacted by a massive tsunami from rocks, space rocks, hitting the Caribbean area, the ocean in that area. And it also indicates there could be a massive refugee problem, both from the Caribbean and from the southern states, pouring into California, pouring into that. Brown refuse spider, refugee spider. They say it's coming from that area, the area of brown skinned people, chocolate skinned people. I keep getting that also, that the sort of chocolate brown skinned people, that's the area the problem will happen, and then there would be massive refugee problems. I say, okay, wow. There's some. Again, the mind is harping on this to an extraordinary extent. I am not interested in this. I am interested in, you know, enlightenment, non-dual abidance. And I'm peace of mind, beauty, and I'm not interested in turmoil and the world, these problems. I don't even pay attention to the news. So this is very annoying for me to keep having these dreams. I said, what in the world? I had this one dream 2 nights ago where I was by this banks of a river. And this is Alaska. I kept saying, you're the governor of Alaska. I'm Alaska. I said, what are you talking about, Alaska? I have no idea what you're talking about, Alaska. Well, when I woke up, I thought about Alaska, and immediately came to me, it's a combination symbol of a dream symbol, ALA and SKA, Atlantic, ALA a la SKA. And I looked up SKA, SKA music comes from Jamaica. And there's been three waves of SKA music in history. Third wave is some British wave, the Europeans have had a couple of waves. There's these, it says, talk about the third wave, the first wave, the second wave, the third wave of SKA music. SKA music is a Caribbean thing, Atlantic, SKA. Helps infer something have to do with Atlantic and Sky, and then that area. So they said the governor of Alaska. So I go to this river, and I'm just sort of looking around at the river, and suddenly, this two fish come flying out of the river, laying in the bushes towards me in this mortal death struggle, horrible. And what it was one fish with a very upright, like a sailfish, some with the fins going, you know, up. It's like thin this way, long, but vertically, very high up vertically, very high vertical, very narrow, widthwise, that kind of fish, had gone horizontally into a long cylindrical type of fish, like a pike fish or something, long cylindrical type of fish, and it got it right in the middle with its teeth, and the momentum of this vertically elongated fish, the power and the momentum of attacking this other cylindrical fish was so strong, it hit the fish with its teeth right in the middle, and the momentum had caused it to go flying out of the water onto the land to an extraordinary extent. I was just shocked, because here was this horrible struggle with these fish taking place right in front of me, where I was back quite a distance from the river. I said, this is impossible. How could this happen? And then the final, it was this very struggle with the flesh, just the immense physicality to it. It was horrible. It was a very powerful fish. And the one that was caught had no chance to escape. I could see that. And so finally the vertically elongated one let go and sort of started to subside back towards the river, get to pull back to the river. And then it came rushing in again and again speared the fish in the center, because the fish was kind of flopping there. It couldn't move hardly. And this time it completely severed the fish in two. It was horrible to behold this. The energy of this fish, the viciousness of this, it just shocked me. The power of this drama that was unfolding, this dream, was just, I walked away. I said, oh my God, this is horrible. Well, so something, what causes fish to leave the water and this fin extending up above the water, what looks like a wave, looked like a wave, its fin, coming out of the water across the land, it pushed this struggle across the land to quite an extraordinary extent. Well, this would be a tsunami. It would be a tsunami. And this sort of elongated fish could represent, it looked like the island of Cuba, or looked like the panhandle of Florida or something like that. It looked like a landmass. You know, it could represent something like that. And then I went through these doors. And I was sort of in a different realm at that point. And there was this young girl, and then she said, "Yeah, I was peeking through the door, looking. Is everything okay there? I don't know. It's scary." And she said, "Oh, so you saw the fish, the conflict there?" And I said, "Yeah." She goes, "Oh yeah, yeah, that happens." And then we had this conversation, and I said, "Wow, I'm being shown something here. It's very important." So there's just another little bit of evidence. She's put the evidence on the scales. So this depicted some, I think, some water, the fish representing the water and its upright fin, like a sailfish, representing the water rising up, a wave, and then this conflict of the ocean being pushed onto the land and spearing the land like that and severing it in two, I mean, just destroying it. How could you make up such a dream? I just said, where did this dream come from? This has got nothing to do with my psyche. This is crazy. So you notice that people are talking about this potential asteroid problem, being blindsided by it. The recluse spider also is unusual. It has these three pairs of eyes, one on the center, one on each side, which is unusual. This could symbolize three fragments. I've gotten this in various ways. Three fragments. It's got three waves. And much, much, much more information. The bighorn sheep knocked down three sets of rocks behind me when I was on the golf course. It just, you know, in was on the 16th fairway that this happened on the golf course. It showed me, you know, very powerfully that something with rocks is going to happen in the year 2016. Again, each bit of information by itself, is just, okay, that's an outlier. But if you keep getting this parade of all this information nonstop, then you start saying, wait a minute, there's a common theme here. Let me just see. There's definitely a common theme. I'm going to just have to... And what's important is that the drumbeats seem to be increasing, and to the point of identifying a date. This is unusual, but I'm not totally unprepared for all this. At the 9/11, I wasn't sure of the date. Same with the tsunami. I was not able to identify the date of the Indonesian tsunami or the location. But in the Ukrainian thing, I was able to find the date and somewhat the location, symbology of it. And this one, I've been able to pinpoint even more accurately, because I'm getting so much information on it. So if we know a certain date that there could be trouble, then from there we say, okay, now what kind of remedy fits this? What kind of remedy fits our situation? Then we become more open to a remedy. We become more open to it. So this is the positive aspect of all this. We become more open to a remedy. Because when the remedy presents itself, we say, oh yeah, that fits the problem that we see coming. Great. Let me go with this then. So it's actually a very, very positive thing to look at it this in the careful, gentle way that we're doing, talking about plausible inference and the constellation and parade of this continually happening. Now, had to go into San Francisco yesterday. Didn't bring my camera. I decided no. Let them be. But it was horrible. It was one of the worst days of my life, worst experiences. It was just horrible. The electronic, the maps, online maps, and even the GPS, the navigator who had a navigator telling me, turn here, this turned out to be very, very flawed. Very, very flawed. And we missed a critical turn, which wasn't shown on any, and the signage is horrible in San Francisco. We got pushed back on the freeway onto the Bay Bridge instead of going into San Francisco. We ended up exiting at Treasure Island, taking a U-turn, then going back into San Francisco. I mean, it's just, you know, the GPS just tells you just turn here, Bryant, right, and left on Fifth Street. There's no problem. Not true. You have to be in the far left lane. The other two lanes get pushed onto the freeway. And there's no signage telling anyone that at all. Just abominable. So finally, we get into to the location where we're going to, like Powell Alice Street. And okay, it's just crowded. It's a madhouse. It's a zoo. Gridlock almost, pedestrians just everywhere, the cars are just it's just people stopping, blocking streets, it is just the worst nightmare possible down there. Finally say, okay, we're free, going to 4th Street, get back on the freeway, free shot. Suddenly the sign says, detour, 4th Street block, what? And it's pointing to the left, and I say, I couldn't get over to the left, and I said, wait a minute, oh, we're really cooked. So I'm going down there, and son of a gun, 4th Street's blocked off. I said, I can't get to the freeway. I don't know this area. What do I do? And then so there's another sign, detour this way. So wait a minute. They said a detour that way. Now it's saying it's this way. Which way do I go? So I took the right, went to the right. And truly, the signage was just horrible. Somehow we got routed through the scene. I kept almost taking wrong turns, and something told me, wait a minute, nah. And I kept thinking, oh, I missed it. But son of a gun, if I didn't finally get to the ramp onto the freeway and we got out of there. Just by the grace of God, I prayed before I went there, the Holy Spirit, to just get us out of that city. I had a feeling it was going to be a problem. And it was a severe problem. I mean, that, what, if we hadn't have somehow taken all those different turns correctly, we would have been trapped in that city for hours. I don't know how to get out of there. It is truly a nightmare there. Again, just abominable signage for all the way around in that city for people coming in. You have to be a local to handle the situation there at all. So it was very metaphoric. It's like Baghdad by the bay. There's that you go there and you can't leave. You get trapped. And but only the grace of God brought us out of there. I'm telling you, people are shouting different instructions. No, you need to turn there. And I just said, no. Intuition was way more successful than the electronics. Way more effective. And this is something I've stressed over and over again, that our spiritual intuition is what is to be relied upon, not electronics. Not artificial intelligence. It's just guesswork. Artificial intelligence is the booby prize. It is truly dressed up stupidity. Okay. It really is. So 100% intuition got me out of that city, thanks to the Holy Spirit. The grace of God, which is our true legacy, got me out of that wretched place. Now, there was a beautiful view from Treasure Island of the skyline. It was quite extraordinary. We didn't stop. I said, wow. Of course, the island is severely polluted with all sorts of cancerous and hazardous toxic chemicals and everything. It's not a nice place to be. But the view was quite spectacular. It was just extraordinarily clear day, winter day. And it's just, it looks like a Legoland or something. It's like surreal, the skyline of San Francisco. But you get down in there and the guts of it, that's a whole different story. What a nightmare that was. Pure grace of God getting out of that place. So, that's interesting, isn't it? As this world is a nightmare, actually. And only the grace of God frees us from this nightmare. And we have to rely upon that. We cannot rely upon electronics, artificial intelligence to tell us what to do at all. It's super flawed, more than super flawed. I pointed out that out ad nauseum. I also discovered people are bragging. They brag like they know more than they really do. Oh yeah, I can handle this. Oh yeah, I know about this. Oh yeah, this is something about the internet generation. They're severe braggers. They think they're way smarter than they really are. Because they think, well, it's right, everything's here on my phone. So if I need to be smart, I've got it right here. And my phone is smart, so I'm smart. It's extraordinary, the stupidity of people, younger people right now. Way, way overconfident. Now, it is true. I believe a truism. My understanding of the mind and everything, the ego, this dream of pretension is the mind that has not repented is looking for an excuse for its own arrogance and pretension to claim it doesn't have these problems, that the problem is out there, not in the, you know. So they're looking for an excuse. And this is why there's so many people have come to this world. You may think, like, well, if an asteroid, there's going to be cataclysms in the world. Why would so many people be here? And the answer is, the people who are here now are those who are excuse seekers. They're excuse seekers. They're looking for an excuse. They say, oh, you see, these inner spiritual problems I have of trying to change reality, etc., that's not the problem. The problem is this catastrophe. That's the real problem. They use it as an excuse. So what I've seen is they're excuse seekers here in the world now. And this is why these people seem to be so, from my standpoint, very dumb. They're here because they're aware there's going to be this great excuse. This whole world is an excuse. This world is known to generate tremendously useful excuses, okay, for us avoiding looking within our own minds and recognizing what's really taking place there. The drama that we have concocted out of pure pretense, and the continuity fear and the defenses we use, and the holy grace of God, and all this to avoid looking at that, they crave excuses. They crave catastrophe, actually. That's why they're here. They're not trying to escape it, avoid it. No, no, no. They're embracing it. They want it. So we have to realize we have 7 billion people on this planet. Almost all of them want some severe catastrophes and wars and troubles to happen, whatever you name it, because that gives them the perfect excuse. Oh, I need to work on this. I need to clean this up. I need to focus on this. I need to... It's external focus, at least to their minds, is external. Nothing's external to the mind, actually. But it's a great excuse to divert one's attention to the true repentance, work of repentance that is necessary. So just because people aren't speaking up about this, see, I've said before in other videos, the reason why everyone knows what's coming, but most people here want it to come. They don't want to escape it. They don't want to avoid it, because it fashions a tremendous excuse for them for failure to repent. It strengthens confusion, which is the ego's gift to us, is confusion, actually. We have to camouflage this through what I call the feminine. The goddess puts a beautiful, so-called beautiful, but a attractive, as we try to make it as attractive, futility as attractive as possible to us, so we'll keep pursuing it. Because if we just look at futility, if it wasn't all dressed up and gussied up and dolled up, we would say, ah, I don't really want this, because futility leads to simply confusion. Because what we're trying to do is we're trying to make illusions real. Okay, we're trying to make illusions real. And we cannot. We cannot make illusions real. So it's futile. It's futile. And futility, trying to make futility a legacy, has no meaning, because those are contradictory, right? Futility and legacy. There's no meaning to futility, is there, in terms of legacy? So there's confusion. And so there's no meaning, there's confusion. When we try to be content with no meaning, we feel very confused. This is what the ego really has for us, is just a severe confusion. I call it mental chaos, actually. I've experienced that. I know this is the legacy. This is what the legacy the ego is trying to give us, is chaos. And yet if we look at it, we say, I don't want that. It's not what I really want at all. So we have to camouflage chaos. Camouflage futility, meaninglessness, confusion. Camouflage it in attractive form. And this is, it's interesting. This is what the feminine does. It camouflages futility. What the males do is they're enablers of this. Okay, they do the enabling. They go out there and get all the raw materials, process it, manufacture it, get all this work to give the feminine the tools to work on camouflaging it. So it's a joint project between the male and the female, sort of thing. Absolutely it is. I'm not saying one is bad and one is good, anything like that. No, they work together. The males are enablers and the females are camouflagers. Absolutely. Deceivers, to dress up futility to make it seem attractive, so we can keep our attention on the ego's goal, which is to make illusions real. And then, of course, the ego says, once I make them real, of course I'll get rid of them. So that hooks us, spiritually hooks us into thinking, oh yeah, the ego is very spiritual, wants to get rid of this bad stuff. No, it just hooks, we stay hooked into it by trying to make it real. Of course, if we made illusions real, we'd claim we're the prime creator. I mean, then we don't have to get rid of them. So, but it's futile to make illusions real. It's like a mirage that keeps receding. We're chasing after this goddess, this beautiful, dressed-up goddess, and always receding, like a mirage, desert mirage, receding. We can never have the legacy of making illusions real. Making lies true. It's impossible. So, but we try to keep our attention attracted to it. Again, if you see it without that facade, you see what it's really like. It's like the beautiful skyline of San Francisco. I mean, you look at it and you say, oh my gosh, this is the Emerald City. The Wizard of Oz must live here. This is, of course, Wizard of Oz may live there, actually. And it's just like, wow, we were transfixed. Just, oh my gosh, look at this skyline, it's gleaming. And then you get down into the actual buildings on the streets, and it's just like, wow, horrible. Just people sprawled out all over the place, homeless people, destitute people, dark, dirty, noisy, crowded beehive of, you know, wow. You just say, holy cow, that's not so nice. In the guts of the Emerald City. Just the same thing with this world. We gussy it up, we dress it up, we doll it up, we put lipstick on it. And to try and keep our, stay attracted to futility. That's all this world is. It's just attraction to futility. And of course, making this great excuse, oh, the futility is not in that it's impossible. It's that there's these catastrophes, and this is why I feel futile. But I can always work on it and clean things up and, you know, make progress off of it. So it's a perfect excuse, isn't it? It's a perfect excuse. Instead of recognizing that we cannot change what we are, it's futile. We cannot change God. We cannot change the light. We cannot change spirit. We cannot change what we are. It's completely futile. Instead of recognizing this and then realizing we need to honor our creativity, which is the legacy the Holy Spirit has given us, has for us, instead, we make excuses. We look for excuses for futility. Oh, I feel futile because of, yeah, there's this problem. There's a war. There's this. I'm losing money. I got the. Always excuse. In the death-free realm, there's no excuse. See, there's no excuses there. Everything's perfect. So that realm is for those who are not making excuses. They say that the problem is within. And the continuity problem, and I've been, you know, working on it, and I'm aware of I want a legacy of at least honoring my creativity. I want to feel there's at least some legacy, and my creativity is the legacy, and there has to be a way that infers reality from that. And that's understood. But so it's again, the ego doesn't want the surprise of troubles coming ahead of time because we might avoid them. And the ego says, no, this will be really helpful for you. So, you know, just block, don't pay attention to what's coming. You know, the elephant's in the room and people are just ignoring it. Because, so there's a surprise. Oh, you know, the ego says, we're having a big surprise party, a big surprise excuse party. It's going to be a great excuse. And people say, oh, great, that's what I really want, ego, thank you so much. Well, that's not what we really want. But it's what we want, egoically, is what we want, is a better excuse. This is true, that what most want still is a better excuse. And we're likely to get one. It's going to be a really great excuse, that this is why we're reluctant to leave this world or to shift somehow, dimension, I don't know, to sidestep it, let's just say. Because it's such a great excuse here. This world's going to concoct this really, really great excuse. We think, ah, Do I really want to not have that excuse? And this is the struggle we're having right now. Because you go to death realm, there's no excuses, which is good. And if you move in that direction, you're moving out of excuses. I don't have an excuse. Don't need to make excuses. Failure, gain, futility comes from trying to change reality. That's where it comes from. It doesn't come from someplace other than that. It doesn't come from outside the mind. It's spirit trying to change reality. That's where futility arises from. Clouded up today. Yeah, they said it'd be cloudy, and it has. Cold and a little cold and cloudy. How about that? So there is extraordinary clarity dawning every day, more and more and more, and then just make it the new normal. Every day is the new normal. It's the new normal. The videos are getting better. Some of the stuff I've done recently for me is, you know, it's better. It takes a lot more work. It's just a ridiculous amount of work of rendering this and knocking out the audio of this and then attaching sound to I have to do, like, I do the graphics and then I record audio on a little audio recorder. Then I have to upload that to a video program, and then I have to apply like a background to the audio so it can render as a movie. And then I have to upload that to YouTube. Then I have to apply music to the audio, and so render that video. Then I have to apply that rendered video to the graphic video which I've uploaded, which sometimes I have to re-render that with a filter to make it bigger, and then I have to join the two and re-render that, and sometimes there's even more rendering and rendering. It's just extraordinary. But it's doable. I mean, I've sort of streamlined it. So I keep trying to present beautiful, inspiring videos that help. Again, the remedy needs to fit the, you know, helps fit the troubles we're having. Well, someone's pointed out to me is five, you got 5 months. They're speaking to people like, what, 5 months? I mean, I got 5 months. What? It's like a very odd thing to say. You got 5 months. Well, starting now, January, February, March, April, May, 5 months. We want to, perhaps June is, you know, moving time or something, possible. Certainly feel something troublesome in July of 2016. This has been on my mind for quite some time now. So what do we do in 5 months, is the question. Well, don't put anything past us at this point, really. Found some very nice background music. I just stumbled upon it, just like, wow. Very, very nice background music. I thank the artist Midori for that on YouTube. It's very, very nicely done. So, I'm able to put some very nice, soothing background music, beautiful, to narration, to beautiful graphics, and sort of drink in this notion of a beautiful, peaceful, serene place where there's no turmoil whatsoever. There's no troubles or turmoil whatsoever. Ah, I keep getting this. Let's see. Where there's no excuses for futility, but we will understand very clearly. I'm getting more and more clear about this, which is why I'm saying maybe I have a little value compared to the great teachers. I have, you know, very little value, but a little, you know, I'm seeing you know, just a little bit. I don't want to overstate it here. It's like a little baby, really, compared to them. But there is some. I'm getting it bit by bit here, really, I am. So, I feel this can continue. It's the new normal. We'll continue. Just keep on. This is the new normal. This is the new normal. This is the new normal. And just go that way. And just take it that way. Don't worry. And the value will increase in terms of clarity about what our true legacy is. And no need to establish a meaningless legacy. Right? Because that's contradiction in terms. Trying to make that, understand that, is, it brings confusion. For trying to understand meaninglessness, it brings confusion. And understanding is how we're trying to get our legacy. We're trying to understand our legacy of what do we do here, what the legacy of pretense, what, you know, our creativity. We've been on this massive effort to pretend for so long now. So we want to first look at it as honoring our creativity as a legacy. So there's ways to establish a new normal every day of clarity. This is what I've been doing, establish a new normal. Just get used to it. Okay, this is the new normal, this is the new normal, this is the new normal. Great. don't struggle with the information. I'd be very careful about that. Just breathe. Just go about your day and realize that this is the new normal for you. To be aware of all this is the new normal. So don't worry about the news, the events of the world, etc., etc. This is not your legacy. This world is not our legacy, actually. We don't have to view this world as our legacy at all. Holy Spirit has a better legacy for us that plausibly infers that reality hasn't been changed, that doesn't generate excuses for us, traumatic excuses. All right? This is the legacy that we claim, not our own personal legacy. I don't need any legacy of my own. I'll just accept the Holy Spirit's legacy for all of us. You see, this is one of the key steps we need to take. It's a legacy for all of us. Now, this is kind of a big step forward I've taken, is seeing this and saying, yeah, you know, that seems listening, being aware of that, being aware of it. Wow, the Holy Spirit has a legacy equally for all of us. No special legacy of a person or anything. It's just an equal legacy for all of us. We all get to partake of the grace of God. That's really the legacy, is the grace of God. That is everyone's legacy from pretending, is the grace of God. To awaken us, to liberate us from this pretending in a beautiful, gentle way. That's our legacy. So the grace of God, which is the Holy Spirit, is our legacy. We don't need to try and make a legacy out of illusions. And keep trying to make these illusions of the futility attractive. And of course, many say, well, I wouldn't know what to do then. The women say, I wouldn't know what to do. The men say, I wouldn't know what to do. I would not know how to be an enabler. Right? The women say, well, I don't know how to dress up. If I can't ornament and dress up and try to make look beautiful and pretty, what do I do? What do I do? And the men say, if I don't enable this, what do I do? So they feel like useless. I wouldn't know what to do. Well, enjoy the beauty of the actual grace of God. Enjoy the grace of God is what we would do. Enjoy the legacy that the Holy Spirit has for us. That's what we do. We enjoy it. Just enjoy it as it is. We don't need to dress it up. We don't need to enable anything. It's already there. Used to be, we've really fallen on hard times here in the world, spiritually hard times. It used to be both the men and women. The women would say to the men, hey, you don't have to go out there and work and try to hustle and cheat and lie and get all this money for me. So buy me new jewelry and new dresses. I don't want it. I wouldn't wear it anyway. I don't wear jewelry. I don't wear ornamentation. I don't wear makeup. And I don't wear a fancy fashion. I just wear very simple, plain clothes that last for 15 years or whatever. I don't need new shoes all the time. I just wear a pair of sandals or whatever. That's it. Don't pursue that for me. Don't be an enabler for me. I don't want it. Instead, you know, study spiritually. Study spiritually. Do your spiritual study. It used to be that way a lot, way more than it is now. Of course, there wasn't much to buy back then, right? Materiality was not so strong. So it's easy for a woman to say, "Well, I don't need anything because there wasn't much to get out in the countryside or whatever." But nowadays, with all the internet shopping and everything, the temptation is a million times more, or more than a million times a million more, in terms of temptation to say, "Oh, look what a great." Decorator, you could be a great camouflager. Look at all this you have to work with now, and the men are thinking, wow, enable. Look how much I could enable here. I've got the capacity to enable all this, you know, this camouflage of futility to take place. So it's a very severe time of utmost temptation in the world. Rarely now do you see women or men who are not affected by this. And to some extent, you go along with just appearances here. Appearances say you don't try to stand out as some anchorite or, you know, walking around in burlap or something, but so, we're not sure what the inner focus of people is exactly, but you can pretty much see those who are materialists. They're just like, oh my gosh, look at all the shopping I can do, and I can make myself so attractive, and I can make the house attractive, I make everything so attractive, and everything new. Oh, wow. I need some enablement of this. Will you enable you to do this? Oh, sure, yeah, that's what I want to do in life. Let me make as much money and enable you to do this. And yeah, it just, people are caught up in materialism. This is the ego. Trying to make futility attractive. Gloss it over. Put lipstick on futility. Right? Give futility a makeover. People are obsessed with makeovers. Beauty salons, makeovers. Go in the surgery, you know, all the stuff you can do to make the body look beautiful. Cosmetic surgery. It's just more and more and more and more and more of that obsession. So presented a balanced picture. This is how it really is. I'm not trying to demonize anyone. Like I said, it's a team effort here to camouflage futility. It's a team effort. So, what kind of videos to make? I don't know. I just let the Holy Spirit decide, if you know, if any. I don't know what's going to happen. I started, speaking of videos, a little background. I started in like 1972 making videos, but before that I was in a movie. My dad lived in Southern California, went to UCLA. He studied, he was photographer and film, studied that at that time, and he actually was in the movies. He was actually a leading man, a quote, not a big movie star, but he starred in a not a major movie, but a movie that was shown, and so he was very much aware of acting and movies and such. And so I was young, he decided to produce a movie. And he had a friend produce the movie here, when using me and some others as actors in the movie and such. And of course, he's very into photography, very good photographer. And so we were exposed to photography and movies from the get-go. And of course, I warned him that the guy he was working for was going to rip him off and double deal him. And he said, "Oh, you're nuts! You're crazy! Yes, I'm having so much fun in this movie." Well, later on, that's exactly what happened. The guy took the movie, took all the money. We never saw anything. Complete thief, you know. And I told him ahead of time this was going to happen. Again, wouldn't listen. But anyway, so it runs in the family. This know-how. And so in 1972, I remember for a project for high school, rented an eight millimeter, was a camera, 8 millimeter, at 8 and 16, I think it was an 8 millimeter, rented a camera, did a school project, and we went to the beach and we shot a movie. And then we worked on developing what, splicing it, developing, we really worked on that. So I've always, that's the, you know, the first start taking video of movies was 1972. And then when the first electronic video players came out with you know, magnetic, I think magnetic to magnetic cassettes and stuff like that, I got a used one of that and started taping. So when the first camcorders came out, I got one of those. I was started taping. I remember the Sony Handycam or something came out, I got one of those. I taped the Brazilian soccer team when they were here at Stanford, won the World Cup. I did all sorts of documentary of that. So I've been doing photography and video basically my entire life. Wherever I went, I tended to have a camera, and it was common. We took a lot of pictures, started off with a little brownie, Kodak brownie, you know, there's a Polaroid came out, and little cameras. We were always had cameras, always wherever we go on vacations, get pictures, 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 yeah. And my dad was a very good photographer when he was young, actually. Made a living during college, helped pay his way through college doing photography. So I've taken a lot of pictures and then done a massive amount of video work. I used to tape my A Course in Miracles practice back in the 90s maybe or something like that. I did hundreds of tapes of that. I don't have them anymore because I think nobody's going to be interested in them, but I would do that. So now it's just this webcam and a little Nikon point-and-shoot camera that also takes video. That's it. Simplify, simplify, simplify. And of course, done a lot of audio recording too. So it is recording, 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 recording is what I've done. And looking back on my life, that's what I've done. Why? To simply try to help people, help spirit here, prepare for what is to come here in this world. Knowing in advance, I was born with this understanding that we're headed towards times of great tribulation and catastrophe on this planet as an excuse, because there's these people want this, these minds want this excuse. They want it. They lust after excuses. This is the most important thing in their mind, is to have an excuse not to do the spiritual work, not to look within for the problem. This is their bad habit. And so there are very, very bad habits that people coming in this world have noticed. Extraordinarily bad habits, mental habits, actually. It's massive overconfidence that not related to any spiritual work at all. So I could record, and this is just easy for me. I can do it. It's something I've just been doing for a long time. Not trying to overdo it in terms of production and this and that. It's just, you know, whatever I can do, whatever I can do, just let it happen. I was thinking of going, taking, you know, video in San Francisco. I said, why do that? Why subject the viewers here to that mess, nastiness, really, as opposed to some beautiful, beautiful landscape and beautiful resort, or, you know, just the gorgeous videos I've been able to put up of nature in its highest aspect, beautifulest aspect that we can find here, reminding us of something better. Why not focus on that? You know, why do some gritty, you know, some gritty city video of derelicts and drug addicts and the nastiness and messiness and noise and cacophony? And why? What's the point of that? Yeah, I mean, people, the attention getter for sure, wouldn't it? Lots of action, you know, you pump the reptilian brain up there with a flight and fight or flight sort of reaction, wouldn't it? But I said, why do that? We can do better than that. I might try something coming up here, possible. I might, I don't know, it's on the back of my mind to go to some nature, beautiful nature spots and do some video, do some taping there, and put some music to it and some audio to it. I can do that. I know how to do it now. Figured out how to do it without jumping through too many hoops. It's not easy. I'm not trying to make it perfect. Keep in mind, I'm not striving for technical perfection on these videos at all. No. I just say it's good enough because we're in a time crunch here. We're in a time crunch. We got no time to fool around here right now. We've got 5 months to elevate our consciousness. 5 months to elevate our consciousness. Let's say nothing happens. Well, that's great. Wonderful. We've still elevated our consciousness. See, so it's win. We win no matter what. That's the great thing on working on elevating, truly elevating our consciousness to non-dual acceptance. We win no matter what. So why wouldn't anyone do that? Of course we want to do this. So but 5 months goes by very fast. This is the thing. We need some help. You know, let's accept some help. Don't pray for it, don't ask for it. It's an insult to those who are capable of helping, because they say, look, I'm capable. You're not accepting it of it. So we have to keep working, and we'll accept it. Let's accept a little help. Okay, not a lot at this point, because we don't think we're worth it very much, right? This is the truth. We think we're not really worth it. But for me, I'm saying, well, maybe a little bit of help. I might be worth a little bit of something possible. I still feel like, you know, just futile, not really able to help at all, but the ability to get into this deep perspective and feel comfortable with it, I say that's got to be at least a little bit valuable, just from the standpoint of reason. I don't feel so much ordinarily like, I can't, what can I do? But from a reasonable standpoint, looking at it, I say, you know, this has to have some value. I feel that it just has some value to be able to handle this clarity at this depth and feel comfortable with it. Got to have some value, because it's just going to get better and better and better, and ultimately it will lead to non-dual abidance. This is what will happen, which does have value. So it's like a precursor to value. So doesn't an important precursor to value have some value? So I would say that those who value this precursor, I certainly would accept some substantive help from them at this point. So we can continue to work on elevating our consciousness. So we're comfortable with an elevated consciousness, so that, you know, surroundings can then match that elevated consciousness. And we'd say, oh, yeah, I'm worth this. I'm worth this. Now the ego says, yeah, but you can have a greater legacy than that. You're selling yourself short. No, the ego is selling us confusion, which that's selling us short, actually. How to truly elevate our consciousness is the question. Don't go after the sex, the drugs, and the rock and roll. Okay, this is the ego's way of trying to camouflage futility, actually, and claiming that's our legacy. We're chasing a legacy there. Well, we're chasing mirage, or catching the mirage is our legacy. You never catch it. So you end up with nothing. You end up with futility. That's all. This whole electromagnetic realm ends up with futility. So I am certainly in a mode of acceptance and of how do we elevate our consciousness in the next 5 months. And allowing that to happen It would just say, okay, I'm going to allow that to happen. Don't try to figure out how to make it happen. To say, I am going to allow this to happen. I'm going to allow my consciousness to be elevated to such an extent that I can allow my surroundings to reflect that elevated consciousness, so that there's no traumatic excuse being presented at all to account for futility. It's like, oh, we almost caught the mirage, but then this terrible disaster happened, and then that's why we didn't catch it. You know, right? We don't need those excuses. That's foolishness, as we know. I tell you, I'm tired of those brown recluse spider dreams. It's just like this someone in the dreams keeps insisting, you got a severe problem with this, you have a severe problem. I say, what are you talking about? So, of course, when people make excuses, they say, well, it's only futile because I haven't been pursuing it, because there's so much problems in the world. But if I really did pursue this mirage, I'd be able to get it, I'm sure. So I just got delayed. But delay's always the excuse. That's what people are working on here, is delay. So they can say, well, I didn't know, it's not impossible, I just got delayed. If I work at it, I can do it. I can make the real unreal. And then experience the reality of the unreality. They want to be able to say, well, I just got diverted because there's terrible problems here. If I didn't have those terrible problems, I could have done it. This is called an excuse. An excuse. Well, my goal, just to keep the elevation going here, right? This is part of elevating our consciousness, of just getting relaxed and comfortable. And this is like the new normal. Okay, this information, well, that's the new normal for me. Not a problem at all. New normal. My goal was to reach 100, 181 by New Year's. I want to be 181. That's been the weight goal. And the Christmas holidays got my weight up to almost 186. I just said, this is horrible. How can I drop 5 pounds in 5 days? Well, I got on the scale this morning. I was 4 or something? Something. I was like, what? What? How'd that happen? It's like a miracle. I don't know. I didn't eat much yesterday. A bunch of dried fruit. So that's pretty good. I'm thinking, like, maybe I'm going to make it. Just today and one more day, and maybe I can make that weight. That'd be tremendous. If I have 5 months, you don't think you can elevate your consciousness sufficiently. Well, how do you know? Like I just said, there's no way I can drop that weight. It just seems too difficult. Boom. There was a 181. So where did that come from? Don't be surprised. You may surprise yourself. You may surprise yourself. And then jumping rope, I wanted to be able to do 100 straight. 100 straight. I just did it this morning. I was pretty much out of breath. That was quite an effort. But I did it without tripping up once. 100 really good jump ropes. Wow. And that was another goal, be able to do that. I still have a goal of 500 jump ropes in one day, but my ankles get sore. I don't want to overdo it. But still, that's pretty good accomplishment to be able to do that without tripping on the jump rope. I mean, every 100 leaps, quick leaps, 100 quick leaps high. I try to leap high. 100 quick leaps in a row without missing a beat. Yeah, that's pretty good. So I'm reaching my goals. I'm reaching my goals. And you don't think you will, but if you just keep your good habits going, you'll have a burst of inspiration and you will succeed. You'll realize, hey, I'm closer than I thought. It's like seeing a finish line and you suddenly have a burst of energy. because you said, I don't think I'm going to make it. I don't think I'm going to make it. And you just hang on and hang on and hang on. And suddenly there's that finish line and say, wow, I used to run this circuit up in the hills, brutally difficult. And you get down, you just feel like, I can't keep going. But there's a sort of a long straightaway kind of where you can glimpse the end way out in the distance there. You can see it. And when you see that, I saw that, and I said, oh my gosh, you know what? I am going to make it. And then I start putting on a burst, and the closer you get, the stronger the burst was. And so you go from feeling like you can hardly take another step, run another step, to like all-out sprint at the end. And this is our psychology. This is how it works. We're very capable of an all-out sprint at the end. Once we can see the goal, we can reach the goal. We're very capable of it. Now keep in mind our practicing, our wow practicing, affirmation, three aspects to it, affirmation, full stop in the wow, and flipping the script. The affirmations are practice. We practice canceling out concepts. We practice canceling out concepts. Our legacy is immeasurable and undefinable and indescribable. That's our legacy. Indescribableness is our legacy. The Holy Spirit shows us that which is indescribable, undefinable, immeasurable, fundamentally so. That is our legacy. This is what we enjoy. We enjoy the indescribable beauty of it all. We're not trying to describe it, because that's not our legacy. What we do is we enjoy our legacy of our creativity. Trying to define what we are is the whole problem we've had. So obviously we're getting freeing from definition. So we practice canceling out concepts in our intense practice, affirmations. When we're doing flipping the script, we're not practicing canceling out concepts, so we can use concepts and in normal conversation. It's okay. So there's no contradiction. We're not going to practice canceling out concepts 24 hours a day, but our thinking is going on 24 hours a day, so use that some of that time to flip the script and so we'll just use a normal structure, pretty much a normal structure, and work on seeing how can we flip this. And so there's no level confusion. We realize there's three aspects to practice, to our practicing. There's level confusion that doesn't bother us. We understand that we set aside a time for affirmations, which you sit quietly with a commitment to no action, because we're going to experience some conceptual disorientation for sure. But we relish that. We say, thank you, this is great. Neither this nor that. Neither that nor this. Neither this nor this. Neither that nor that. Okay, this is the basic framework, you might say, for canceling out concepts. Neither this nor that. Neither that nor this, neither that, neither this nor this, and neither that nor that. And we're not trying to figure this out. This has a profound effect on it conceptually. We feel, well, it must be immeasurable and inexpressible and undefinable then, right? Our experiencing. So my experiencing is neither this nor that, and it's neither that nor this, and it's neither that, nor this nor this. However you want to keep the order of those, doesn't really matter. it's inexpressible and undefinable and immeasurable. This feeling of immeasurability and inexpressibility and undefinableness, this is the legacy. This is our legacy that the Holy Spirit honors our creativity with. So we abide in this legacy experience, is what our goal is, to abide in this legacy experience, instead of pursuing the ego's legacy of futility. And then the excuses it used for not reaching it is, well, you could have succeeded, but you got diverted. Oh, isn't it terrible? I got this catastrophe here. Oh, that's bad luck, isn't it? But it's not your fault. You know, so okay, eventually you'll get back to, you know, succeeding at futility. It's really that stupid. It really is just like that. So I don't know what to do with myself, really. And just let the Holy Spirit, I just... Serendipity, just have to let serendipity play its role. We try not to get too adrenalized, is important. I had to drink a mocha cappuccino coffee yesterday. I'm getting very fatigued at like 2:30 or 3 in the day. It just hits me so bad. It's just horrible. I said, what's wrong? And I had to drive to San Francisco right during this time. I said, I'm going to fall asleep. I can't handle this. So I had to take emergency measures. Well, I had a caffeine hangover this morning. It's terrible. It's very nasty. You can feel how it really guts you, your nervous system. It's worn off to some extent. But it can lead to adrenalized music, adrenalized this, adrenalized that, and very dangerous. Caffeine's very dangerous, actually. So, avoid the bad habits. Stay with the good habits. It works. It works. I've just continually kept working out a little bit, stretching, flexibility, and been able to carry through these holiday season here, Christmas season, able to carry the good habits through. They're still with me. I thought I was going to have trouble, but and by carrying enough momentum through, you're able to put on a burst of speed at some point too. This is what's important. We may be schlepping along like on a long run, and we're tired. When we see the finish line, we say, wow, I'm going to just go for it. So don't just wait for something great to happen. Just keep doing the hard, the tough work. Grinding away. I'm grinding away at videos, presenting stuff that's evocative, plausible inference, something that is... Lamentations and Response video. A lot of work on that. It took days. And it's very interesting video. The background graphics are quite interesting, how that came about. And people just lamenting, saying their expressions, just saying, wow, this world is just terrible. I feel trapped here. I can't get free. This is hideous. I don't know what to do. I mean, despair is my constant companion, which is how we feel. This is the way we all feel. And then the true light speaks to us and gives us plausible inference that all is well. Don't worry, this is mere pretense. That pretense has no external cause. So don't go looking for an excuse. There's no external cause at all. It's not causative at all. Pretense is not causative. Yeah, so we're entirely in control of our experiencing, actually. Everyone is. 100% in control of all our experiencing. We're just pretending that we're not. We've got this little collective agreement to go along with this pretense here in this world, in this universe, that we're subject to natural disasters and all this kind of stuff. No, it's all pretense. We're not subject to anything. It's just this big collective agreement that we're engaging in to try and change reality, make illusions true. Yeah. So again, like for me, I just have to keep working on good habits during the day, every day, waiting for lightning to strike and some little bit of willingness for some help here to help elevate my consciousness in the next five months. We could use that help. There's no question that in my dreams, I'm certainly, there's this figure that seems to be Sri Sri Anandamayi, but I'm, of course, I'm very, very, very careful about this whole thing. It could be the goddess deceiver, right? It could be the deceiver, the deceiving goddess, who is the one, and we've a supplemental projection of how to put attractive facade to futility, to chasing after futility. So I'm not saying for sure it is or not, what exactly, but there's this figure keeps showing up in my dreams. And that little girl that I talked about, she keeps looking up and like this, like something's coming from the sky, like she's watching something coming, falling down from the sky. This little girl's eyes felt was inspired by the Holy Spirit in some way. The signs were there. And that's her characteristic. Something's coming from the sky. Look up, look up, look up. You know, it's coming from the sky, or something's coming. So maybe it's the rapture, I don't know. So there's that. Could such a being inspire us? Sure, absolutely. In some way, could Longchenpa, could Jesus, could Rama Maharshi, could this, could that, could that. All of that is possible. Anandamayi Ma was a super guru. So she's more than capable of doing tremendous help, if that's what we ask for and allow for. But the way they help us, it's hard to connect the dots. It's very difficult. Now, I think she did a great job here. It's hard to say what's exactly why she came here at this time. And in hindsight, you can draw some inferences, plausible inferences. I think, one inference I can draw is that she knew, of course she knew the catastrophes are coming, and our desire to sidestep it, we need to elevate our consciousness to do so. So it helped out in that a great deal, helped overall the world elevate its consciousness. But also, she's provided a contrast with the egoic dynamic of the female-male, the camouflager and the enabler of the camouflage. She provided a very strong contrast with that. Also, I found that camouflage goddess, the goddess of camouflage, felt very, very threatened by her. Because, you know, it's completely different working for the light. And so the idea of a woman coming in the world who had no pretense at all was extraordinarily threatening to the feminine component of the ego here. And they really got into very severe competition with her. And this is what I've experienced and been aware of. In other words, they tried to match her attractiveness. She was the attractiveness of the true light, that attractiveness. And so they tried to copy, imitate, compete. It was beneath it. It's very subtle, but I was aware of it. No question about it. I remember back in, even in the 60s, there were the women somehow found out about her through some of the jet-setting women and stuff. They become aware of various things, and it filters through magazines. It goes through the grapevine. I don't know. It's just really subtle how it happens, but it does. And they're trying to imitate her style, imitate how she looked, the mannerisms and flowers, all sorts of stuff. Well, what happened was she sort of forced the hand of this world, the egoic play of trying to camouflage and make futility look attractive. She forced them to overdo it. So they've overdone it. And in overdoing it, trying too hard, see, part of the attractiveness of camouflaging is sort of the making look the ease of it. And there's kind of, there's a way of doing it that we kind of just let it slide and say, okay. But if you overdo it, it starts getting pretty nasty and demanding, and you start saying, well, wait a minute, that's not so attractive. So what I see is Anandamayi Ma forced the hand. It was a very intrepid gambit that she did, very much so. She forced the hand of the egoic camouflage program here, camouflaging futility, to overplay their hand. to cause them to overplay their hand. And in doing so, it's now very easy to recognize what they're doing. Whereas before, it wasn't so easy at all. So, talk about a legacy. This is how I see it. She knew exactly what was going to happen and forced them to overplay their hand, the ego to overplay his hand. So now you have, you know, the women, men matrix here. It's very nasty and very obvious. Women have overplayed their hand in terms of their power play and demands and the way they are. And they're no longer attractive at all. You realize, wow, they got terrible personalities. And no amount of beauty can hide that now. They've sort of been forced, been outed. She sort of outed the whole thing. And then the men who slavishly attend to these women, they just realize just what a bunch of drunk slaves. I mean, this is not attractive at all. You know, the wimpy, the way they are is not attractive either. So I don't want to be like that. There's no way. So they've overplayed their hand. The ego forced the ego to overplay its hand and makes it very much easier to say, ah, forget it. So this is what's been going on, really, beneath the surface. So that's how I see it, which is a great, 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 great gambit and legacy to do. It's like a firebreak. I mean, it's really quite exciting. It's very difficult. It's like, wow, you know, very intrepid play. And it worked. It worked. It worked. If I can say that, it really worked. I've been able, you know, more and more and more seeing like, wow, that's not attractive at all. That's very unattractive. And I see the male-female roles now. It's very unattractive. I see being an enabler of these pseudo-goddesses, you know, these goddess attraction to futility goddesses. I see a very unattractive role. And I see that these pseudo make futility attractive goddesses as being very, very venial and nasty and vicious and arrogant and having extraordinarily unattractive personalities. Just like, wow, no thank you, no thank you. Overplayed their hand. Pretty, very interesting standpoint. They had to. They panicked. They said, oh my God, we can't let Sri Sri Nandamayama get into the consciousness of the world because, you know, people are going to go in that direction. The ego says, oh no. This is a curtains for us if we let it go in that direction. So they had to respond. Had to respond. And respond they did for sure. And it seemed terrible as to be dragged down as we've been dragged down. But again, at this point, we can look at it and see how unattractive the ego really is, how unattractive it all is. It's really wretchedly unattractive. And I know I would not have had that attitude if not for the work she did. And the inner work that I did too, I would have been tricked by it. Tricked by it. But just the pretension now is going in this world is just suffocating pretension. Just horrible. And you say, well, why this is overplayed. If you just backed off, maybe it wouldn't seem so bad. But it's too late. I mean, it's too late. They overplayed their hand. It's can't put it back in the box. It's too late for that. And that's a great blessing for us. This is a spiritual blessing that the ego's had to overplay its hand. We might be looking at the world and say, oh my God, it's wretched, how terrible. No, it's great. It's great. Because we say, I don't want this. Look at this. This is what this, and then it's the ego's exposed, brought to light. We say, oh my gosh, this is what's really been going on with the female-male thing. And the diva thing and you know, lipstick culture and all this is putting lipstick on the pig of futility. And the men just being these craven enablizers, enabling it. You know, they're thinking this is the only role I have. My God, how terrible. So it's very unattractive. And this is a blessing for us, a great, great blessing. I feel very strongly that Sri Sri Anandamayama played a pivotal role in this. Very pivotal. She absolutely threatened the whole egoic structure of this world to an enormous extent, and they were desperate to co-opt her. They tried. They absolutely tried to co-opt her, offering her tremendous inducements. Literally, they will make you the preeminent person in history. Your legacy will be greater than anyone that's ever been here. And there was a way to do that. And she said, sorry, but I can't do that. It's not part of my grace that I'm just following along with. The grace of God that I said, I don't do anything of myself. It's just the grace of God as it unfolds moment by moment. And this is just not something that is going to, I can see that it's, you know, this is not what I'm here for. It's not what I'm about. She was going to be the mother of India, the mother of the new India, the mother of the new spirituality in the entire world. Could be put upon a pedestal like no one else. And she said, no. That has nothing to do with what I'm here for. So, and they put the screws to her too, and it didn't work. Mahatma Gandhi put the screws to her. And all sorts of, Indira Gandhi put the screws to her, the whole Nehru family and all. It was very heavy power structure in the world that was trying to get her to agree to this, and she just brushed it off as just no, zero interest to her. And so that really rang the bell of the world, just saying, whoa, we got competition. See, women don't expect competition in that way. It really threw them for a loop. Because most of the great saints and gurus have been men. So women have adapted to this and said, we can still work this attractiveness thing, you know, in this way. And then the men enablers have adapted to it. The whole egoic lipstick culture trip, putting lipstick on the pig of futility, had found, trying to wiggle room there, and then here comes this woman in, and they just like didn't know what to do. So they got into competition with it. And that caused them to become really, really piggish. You know, you can see the pig there. Do you see past the lipstick? Absolutely. Absolutely can. Can feel that animal nature sort of thing is just emerging really terribly now. Before, women had it more under wraps. They could pretend better that it wasn't there. Now they've been driven out into the open, becoming very, very animalistic. Extraordinarily so. They think, well, can't you put on a little better pretense? Oh, this is horrible. You're blowing the cover. Your cover's blown. What are you doing? You know, like the enablers in men, they're saying, what are you doing? We can't enable this. This is making us look like fools. I mean, this is horrible. You've just blown the cover. You know, we can say, oh, great. You know, another way of looking at it, oh, thank you. Thank these great teachers. And Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma was absolutely pivotal in this. Really, really, really threatened the ego so severely. So then here we are years later now with this opportunity to elevate our consciousness and see past the false attractiveness of this world and these roles that we've been playing, these projections of appearance, these appearance projections that we've been utilizing. It's just this trying to keep ourselves pursuing futility. This is how we, until we can think we can experience being greater than God, we feel we have to keep pursuing futility until we catch it. And until it becomes meaningful for us. Like Jesus said in the Course in Miracles, I feel bad because I'm seeing a meaningless world. I'm upset because I'm seeing a meaningless world. That's why I'm upset. I'm not upset for the reason I think. I'm upset because I'm seeing a meaningless world. My meaningless thoughts are showing me a meaningless world. Well, good thing I didn't go out. today and pursue some beautiful, it looked like a gorgeous day to go out and take some video. It's all very gloomy and cold now. It just changed on a dime. That's really something. Holy Spirit, write again. So again, we have this one website of a lady who's for more than a decade, I think, has put on a website of warning from, she's getting from a higher source, and has been, you know, more than most in the ballpark about what she said, more than most for sure. Pretty much in line with what's going on, and then she says now that that's it, that this is, trouble is now very, very close here. Now, her theory is we're going to be evacuated from the planet. I haven't gotten any heads up on that at this point. I still believe we have 5 months to elevate our consciousness, and then we'll see where that gets us. She seems to be indicating it sooner than that, but we'll see. But certainly, it's been indicated some sort of sidestepping is likely to take place because the ego is desperate, truly desperate, for a big excuse, monster excuse, the mother of all excuses. So it can say, well, you didn't catch futility because you were diverted by these terrible problems, and it's not your fault, don't worry, you'll eventually get back to it, and then you'll succeed. It's an excuse. It diverts our awareness from the fact that futility can never be meaningful. What meaning can futility have? Except to say, well, I can't accomplish, you know, changing reality. What kind of meaning does that have as far as positive legacy? What kind of legacy is futility? See, those are contradictory. Say, my legacy is futility. That's a mental contradiction. Meaning, say, well, there's nothing. I completely fail. Well, legacy means leaving is your accomplishments. So if you say my legacy of futility or legacy of no accomplishment, it's, which we try to grasp that, it's confusion. Legacy of futility, that's confusion. And so we need an excuse to not realize that confusion, to recognize the confusion as what it is. And the ego provides these excuses. So I say, no, the confusion is not coming from this legacy of futility, it's coming from this confusion of civilization has just collapsed. Now, keep in mind, I've always said that the 9/11 was a sign of Jonah, the sign that we were told in the Bible that the only sign that will be given, even an adulterous generation, is the sign of Jonah, the whale. He wandered in Nineveh for 3 days. There's the three again. Jesus was in the grave 3 days, with Friday, Saturday, and then risen on Sunday. The World Trade Center was three planes, right? The two Twin Towers, one was one plane each, and then one in the Pentagon, supposedly. And then one was down in a field, didn't hit anything. So it was not a problem. Well, this symbolizes three impacts of an asteroid splitting up. Most likely splitting up. It'd be pretty unusual if three different asteroids came at this similar time. You know, it would be pretty unlikely, I would say, that the heat and pressure of a big asteroid coming in could easily, the pressure build up, and poof, it can split into three fragments. That's what I've always believed. That's what it symbolized. It's a heads up. And also it's a heads up to show the domino effect of asteroids hitting this world. It's not just a tsunami, it's a domino effect. And the fact that these Twin Towers and World and Trade Center 7, number 7, all collapsed the way they did was just extraordinary. It symbolizes the collapse of civilization and ecostructure and the ecosystem of this planet. Don't expect it. I mean, certainly. Nobody expected those buildings to collapse, especially World Trade Center 7. There's some sofas on fire, and the whole thing came down like a demolition. Sofa fire. Squat. It wasn't hit by anything. I don't know any reinforced concrete building with massive steel uprights and massive rebar everywhere and massive concrete. I don't know of any sofa fire that could cause such a building to collapse in its own footprint perfectly. That's so funny and absurd. You can't help but laugh. If you work in construction, how can you not laugh at that? You ever try to take out reinforced concrete? Yeah. We just took some out, or some sub con con people took it out. We were there. I mean, slaving and slaving and slaving. My gosh. It's very difficult. That's not even with massive steel beams. So a sofa fire, and no jet fuel there in separate World Trade Center 7. No jet fuel, nothing to cause intense heat. It office fire, and the whole building imploded from the ground, from the bottom floors. Just the whole thing just collapsed into its footprint, exactly like a demolition. So anyway, it symbolizes the collapse of civilization, sudden collapse from three fragments, which is why we've all been pretty nervous since then. And all the global terrorism also symbolic, symbolizing unexpected, being hit unexpectedly, terribly in unexpected ways. But again, the overall ecosystem of the planet is impacted by asteroids. This is something the scientists are starting to figure out. Because we think, oh, okay, a tsunami, everything's fine. No, it's not that simple. See, we're thinking of tsunamis, earthquakes causing tsunamis, and we say, okay, it's terrible, but then we get back to normal. But no, an asteroid is very different. Very, very different. Causes enormous atmospheric repercussions, which have enormous ecosystem repercussions, and the whole ecosystem can pretty much collapse. That seemed to have happened in history on several occasions, but the dinosaurs being the most noticeable one. All these dinosaur themes in the world right now, maybe it's the same way of saying, hey, you remember what happened to the dinosaurs? Guess what? History repeats itself. As long as we keep wanting mother of all excuses, it keeps repeating. We keep projecting these occurrences, these experiencing, this excuse. Not recognizing futility and confusion for what their origins are. What is truly causing this? Not looking within the mind, see what is the real origin of this feelings, the feelings that we're having. They're not coming really from the world at all. That's not the true origin. How are we doing? Are we doing well in this video? It's a good idea here to keep the ball rolling. Keep the ball rolling. That's the name of the game. I'm practicing doing jumps. I'm jumping on a step, like the doorstep here. I don't know how high it was. It's 6 inches, 8 inches. Isn't it? You know, and I just leap from the patio area to onto the doorstep. Just both feet at the same time, spring onto it, then jump. And I jump out backwards off of it. Jump onto it. Jump backwards off it. Jump onto it. Jump backwards off it. Practice jumping like that. A quick leap. A quick leap. Spring, a quick spring. So get spring to your step. Okay, literally. Practice spring to your step. Practice hopping. Not a leap off of one leg, but both legs together. See if you have some spring in your step like that. Oh, I told you again, I remember the golf course. I was going up that hill. It's a very steep hill. I look for a golf ball, and suddenly these rocks, boulders come down right at me. And I was able to spring over them. I leapt up over them. boom, hit the golf carts. It's like, wow. So that symbolizes a quick ascension, so to speak, a quick ascension, but an easy one, easy one. Because our consciousness is already elevated enough, so it's no problem. So a quick ascension, sudden quick ascension, was what was required for not to get hit by those rocks. The guy that dropped all the serendipitous spiritual code on me, Holy Spirit code, which I recognized, part of it was, he said he got hit and injured all along his whole side, fractured this, fractured that, his whole side was severely injured and he couldn't pursue his life goal anymore. He told me about that. Just out of the blue, it was told strangers, like, wow. Yeah, more and more and more. He had everything to do with water and things flying off unexpected. Oh, it was just amazing. It's like a custom-made situation that just everything there clicked in exactly to show me what's coming. So civilization collapsing, we can't pursue. We can't pursue our futility like we used to. So we say, well, our failure is because of this problem. So if we just get back to it and reconstruct it, then we'll be able to keep going. This is a psych job on ourselves, diverting our attention from the inner work we need to do, giving us an excuse to say, well, it collapsed because of the asteroid, not because of the futility of it, therefore it sets up a future pursuit of it, where we feel like, okay, we haven't really exhausted our efforts yet. That's how cycles continue, sets up future pursuit of futility, by giving us an excuse for why we didn't succeed. Very interesting, isn't it, to look at it this way? That helps elevate our consciousness, just that in itself. So a quick elevation in consciousness, I would say, it might be on tap for us. When we have to. When those rocks were coming at me, for a moment I said, I don't know what I got to do, and then something told me in my mind, said, leap. And I said, I tried, and I did. I got airborne. I could leap. I haven't been able to leap for so long. So it really surprised me. I could get airborne like that. But after it, I just like, wow, this is great. I did it. I was saved from disaster. So it's possible a quick airborneness may happen. The Christians believe that's what will happen. This is in their the way that they've been informed by the Holy Spirit. The grace of God is a quick airborneness. They call it the rapture. They believe Jesus will return the clouds of heaven, like the way he departed. What clouds of heaven are a code for some sort of transport vehicles. It could be interdimensional vehicles shifting, some sort of interdimensional shift, some realm shift of some sort. But the Christians believe it's a very sudden, quick springing into the air, so to speak. So there's been indications, I've gotten indications that there's something that along those lines is possible. I don't have specifics. I would suggest physically practicing jumping off the ground, both feet springing simultaneously up that way. It's a vertical, not a horizontal leap, but a vertical spring. Go vertical. Go vertical, not only with our consciousness, but with our body. Go vertical with our momentum. Even have physical momentum going vertical. So that's why I'm doing jump rope, and I'm instead of just like barely skipping off the ground, I'm trying to leap as high as I can with each jump. It's almost like weightlessness. I'm leaping that high, I can't even, all my momentum is going upwards, I can't even get the rope to hardly go down. It's weird. So they're just jumping up, leaping, jumping up as high as possible. It's kind of fun. It's quite exercise. It's really just try that when you're, getting older. It's doable. Never in my wildest imagination believe I would be doing jump rope or leap rope when I'm almost 60. That's like, what? Why am I doing this? But here it is. Also working on the flexibility of the golf swing, a sudden be able to drive the ball, really far. Really drive it out there and right in the middle of the beautiful, beautiful emerald green fairway somehow. There's something to do with that, getting it airborne with power. Really getting it airborne with power. Really escaping the tee. And the swing is right now is getting very powerful. It really is. It's like wow. Now these are just practice swings. You get on the golf course, you freeze up and try to aim it, and you don't swing like you did on practicing. But these practice swings now are I had some just after doing the jump rope thing. It was just astonishing. Just astonishing the speed and power of that swing. I mean, it's more enjoyable even to have just these swings than even hitting a golf ball. Is that really? Because with a golf ball, something can go wrong. With these swings, nothing can go wrong. It's just pure speed and power and timing and just wow. Love it. That's very enjoyable in itself. And doing this jump rope is enjoyable in and of itself. It's fun to feel yourself kind of being airborne, almost like weightless as you're jumping up like this over and over and over and over. You almost get this like, almost like a weightless feeling. So maybe in the next 5 months, you could get on a weight program and a exercise program along with raising the spiritual consciousness too. Like do three different programs. Elevate the spiritual consciousness through talks, through spiritual practice, through videos, through going beautiful places and whatever you can do. Work on weight training programs to get your weight really, really light. Try to get yourself lighter, lighten up that way, and then try to exercise and try to do these jumping exercises and get your flexibility in jumping. And if we really work on it, we'll see where we're at. I've been working on this since the beginning of September, August 29th. Let's just say September, October, November, and most of December. So it's pretty well. Today's the 29th, 30th. So it's been 4 months now. 4 months. So I've been on a 4 month intense program of elevate my spiritual consciousness, work on strength and flexibility, and jumping, and work on the golf swing, which is applying that strength, flexibility, and weight loss, applying it to a sudden, quick timing motion that everything clicks together and just exactly right. This is what the golf swing is. Everything has to click just right. But when you do it, it just whips through with extraordinary speed and intensity. And your body is thrown forward, but keep your balance just right. And it's like, wow. Wow. You feel the coordination of it all. So it brings this feedback to you, like, wow, there's something that's all can be all coordinated just like that in it, and it can result in a tremendous uplift, tremendous depth uplift, uplift of great depth. I mean, you drive the ball out there with great depth of distance, so to speak. And it's a beautiful thing watching a drive like that. Just like, wow, so beautiful. How did that happen? How did I make that? How did I get that, make that happen? So why not do 5 months like that? Why not? Should I cook up a website and, say the 5 month program? We got a 5 month program here. Let's get with it. I don't know. I've never had any feedback. Maybe it's only been one person. I think I've maybe had two people on all the websites I've ever done. I've done only two people I think I've ever delivered any feedback at all. Amazing. Absolutely extraordinary. But, hey, who knows what can happen now? But that's just an idea of a program. I mean, got to, I would say these next 5 months, got to focus on good habits and make it a threefold is an easy way to deal with it. Our practice is threefold. Our habit practice could be threefold. Our spiritual practice, threefold. Assertions, full stop in the wow, flipping the script. We could have a threefold program of elevate our consciousness, spiritual consciousness, as much as possible. Work on our weight and overall health, food consciousness, weight conscious thing. And then work on our flex strength and flexibility, agility, consciousness too. Get all three of those humming. After 5 months, I guarantee if you really work at it, you're going to be in way, way more confident feeling than you are right now. Because in 4 months, I've already done it in 4 months' time. So I've already proven it can be done in 4 months, so we can certainly do it in 5 months, can't we? Interesting. Very interesting. Okay, I will think about this. I will not think about it. I will let this percolate and see what can come about this. If there's any feedback anyone has about it, I would very strongly suggest everyone in the world to work on a program in the next 5 months of intensely working on good habits, and not to give up. Give it a 5 month program and refuse to give up. It'll be easy to give up. I felt like this program I've done, there are times I'm so down, I feel so sluggish and weak, I can't do it. But I've persevered and feeling pretty doggone good about it right now. So you will have ups and downs for sure, but if you just say, no, I have 5 months and I'm going to give it everything I got and see where I stand after 5 months. I'll guarantee that you look back, you will not regret it. You'll say, wow, I'm so glad I did that. So glad I did that. So maybe we all need to order jump ropes. So get jump ropes, right? Why not? I mean, I found that people hate to take advice now. It's funny, the homily, there's this priest that we like. He's a young priest, and he's very intelligent, and he has very, very good homilies. I have a lot of respect for him. And he's been gone for several months, not giving Mass, and he came back first time in several months, last Mass, and he said, look, his whole homily was give advice to your friends, to your loved ones, to people. Just start giving good advice to people. He says, this is what you need to do right now. And I said, wow, and of course he says, what do you do when you give advice to people in your family? They're not going to listen to you, are they? They're the last people in the world to listen to you. I've never had people follow my advice. It's extraordinary, crazy, how resistant people are to following anyone's advice. But he said it's time to do that. Give good advice. Of course, the ego will sabotage whatever efforts you make. That's what the ego does, is sabotage efforts towards truth, to giving up on futility and accepting the Holy Spirit's legacy that already is there for us without us doing anything. The grace of God is the legacy we have from this excursion, of this misadventure of whimsicality, that's already present right now, fully present right now. But the ego sabotages it. So you give advice to people who are close to you, that also gives them an excuse to sabotage it. You. This is what I found out. So it might be a dangerous thing to give advice to your family. You probably know what I'm talking about. They're experts in sabotage. Derailing. Expert derailers, like derailing a train, right? This train momentum you have, they'll expertly go to work and start shifting the train ties on the track until the whole thing derails. So I generally don't let the family know what I'm doing. They have no idea. And then I'm able to succeed. As soon as I let them know I'm doing something, I find all sorts of derailment, sabotage happening subtly. This is the way that it is in this world. But I've certainly given advice to the world world at large here that this is be a very good idea to do this. Don't let yourself drift at this point right now. Got to seize the day, carpe diem, be a spiritual marine right now and say, I'm going to boot camp. 5 month boot camp And then we'll reassess in June. We'll reassess. We're not going to assess, until June in terms of, well, I gotta quit. Oh, there's a no. Go finish the boot camp and then decide, then see how you feel. So I'm looking back right now to say, wow, I'm so much better off now than I was 4 months ago, even though I'm still relatively suffering terribly. But compared to where I was at and the direction I was circling the drain, I'm way better off, way better off. So lean and mean and able to still be very focused here and very intense. You're suffering from fatigue in the afternoon. This is it's just a stress. It's stress. Very strong stress. Because it's go time, and we're gonna go. Either we're going to whip ourselves into shape in the next 5 months, or we're going to collapse with the rest of the knuckleheads, lipstick culture, who is going to seize upon the excuse that's custom made, that we've custom made here for ourselves in this world. That's what they're expecting, to bail them out. They're not on this taking the spiritual path, and they expect to be bailed out, so they don't have regrets. They say, "Oh, you see, that's all a waste of time, because look what happened. I couldn't have succeeded anyway. Look at this terrible problems the world has now." That's they're going down the path of excuse. They think this is going to bail them out. No, it'll just cause them to have another cycle of pursuing futility, so they don't have to face the inner truth. But that's what the spiritual path is all about, and it's wonderful to face the inner truth. It's absolutely wonderful. I've had a blast doing it. It's just been great, very intense, but just wow, so much wow to it. The wow has its own grace to it, really. It's full of grace, the wow, and recognizing the mistakes we've made is full of grace. It's enjoyable. It's intense, there's a burn to it, but it's very enjoyable. So, 5 months boot camp. Yeah. I would very strongly suggest this at this point. It's plausibly inferred, okay? I cannot prove it evidentially, in an evidentiary, empirical, scientific way. I'm saying, from the standpoint of spiritual awareness, there's a very strong, plausible inference that this is would be a very smart move to make. A smart bet to place, a smart bet on yourself. It's a smart bet to place on yourself. Whereas not doing anything and just continuing to drift with the news cycle, and I think that's a very unwise bet to place on yourself, because you're betting on this excuse. The excuse will likely come, but that's a losing game. That's a game of delay. Okay, very great. That's it. I'll get to work and see how come of this.